In this video, we're going to be talking about how we measure energy in the body. So let's go ahead and get right to it here. Let's start off by talking about calories. So one calorie, or a small calorie, is the energy required in order to raise 1 gram of water from 14.5 degrees Celsius to 15.5 degrees Celsius. If you take 1,000 of these calories, that is 1 kilocalorie, which is what's on the dietary labels in most countries around the world. In the United States, we don't say kilocalorie, even though that's what it is. So our dietary label calories is a kilocalorie. And so another name for this would be a large calorie. And just quickly here, because it's going to relate to how we measure energy in the body, we learn how much energy is in food by burning the food in what's called a BOM calorimeter, which is what this is showing. So we have this little canister here, which is called the BOM, and we put the food in it, and we literally are going to burn that food in an attempt to warm up this water because it's sitting in this water bath, and then we just measure the temperature change of that water, and that's how we can calculate calories. All right, so we can do a fairly similar approach in measuring the energy expended from a person as well in something that's called direct calorimetry. Here's an example of a direct calorimetry room. So in this kind of room, it very similar to the BOM calorimeter, we have a person, maybe they're sitting, maybe they're watching television, maybe they're exercising like the example here. And in the walls of that room are pipes filled with water. And we can measure how much heat's in the water as the water goes in. We can measure how much heat's in the water as the water comes out. And so we know the change in temperature of the water. And that change in temperature came from the person that's inside the room heating up the air, which eventually heats up the walls and then heats up the water. And so this is how we can directly measure the energy used and the energy expended by the body, which is why it's called direct calorimetry. The body has a fairly stable ratio of how much of its energy is dissipated off into heat versus useful energy. So about 40% of our energy is going to turn into ATP, which is our useful energy, while 60% of our energy is going to be turned into heat, which would then go through this process, heating up the water that we would measure. And so you can use this fairly standard ratio in order to figure out how much energy this person's using, even though not all the energy is turning into heat. So there's some pros and cons to using direct calorimetry in order to measure people. The main pro, it's pretty accurate over a relatively long recording time. And it's good for doing resting measurements or sort of living measurements where a person's living in the space, right? So, allow them to kind of go about their day a little bit in this tiny little room, maybe, sitting on a computer or something like that. And you can measure how much energy that they use doing that. The cons to it is it's very expensive. It takes a long time to do, and obviously it takes a lot of space. There's a lot of error if you start throwing exercise equipment in there that might have friction. Think treadmills and the belt going around and all the friction that's going to cause, the heat that's going to cause. Sweating also causes errors in this, because as we sweat, we are going to dissipate heat through means that isn't just the heat radiating off our body. It's going to evaporate off, which is going to change the way that the sort of heat from our body heats up the room. And let's face it, this is just not a practical method of measuring the body, and it's certainly not going to be practical for measuring exercise. And so it's very rarely that people still use direct calorimetry rooms in order to do this. It can be done. It does get done, but it's rare. If somebody wants to measure free living energy expenditure, they're probably going to use a technique called doubly labeled water, which is a little more complicated to get into, so we're not going to get into it here, but it's another method of measuring energy usage, but it's typically used over longer periods, days, weeks, not so much hours, which is what a direct calorimetry room would be probably pretty good at. So instead of doing direct calorimetry, we do what we call indirect calorimetry, where we're not measuring body heat anymore. And so instead of using body heat, we measure gas changes. All right, so we can do this using equipment like what we see here, where there's usually some sort of face mask or a mouthpiece that has to go in the mouth. And what we do is we actually collect all the air that comes out of the person, and we put it through a tube, and it goes to a metabolic cart like this one here, where it is then going to be analyzed so we can figure out how much oxygen and how much CO2 is in that air. If you want to learn how you can use a cart like this, you can scan this QR code or type in this link here. I'll also put a link to this in the description below. This is a video I did a while back showing how to use a metabolic cart in order to measure VO2. So how does this all work? We know the basic ratios of gases in the atmosphere. No matter where you are on Earth, it's about the same level. So the same percentage of oxygen, the same percentage of CO2. And so if we know how much oxygen and CO2 is in the room, which we do, and we measure it coming out of the body, we can figure out how much oxygen was used by how much oxygen is not there. So basically how far it dips below atmospheric levels. And we can measure how much CO2 is produced by how much CO2 increases above atmospheric levels of CO2. And so based on, again, knowing how much is in the atmosphere and how much comes out of the body, we can figure out things like VO2 and VCO2. So VO2 is the volume of oxygen that inspires or brought into the body minus the volume of oxygen expired from the body. So what is the difference between the two? That is your VO2 or oxygen consumption. VCO2 is how much CO2 is produced, and these are both per minute. And so this is going to be VCO2 equals volume of the expired CO2 minus the volume of inspired CO2. So again, figuring out that difference, it's going to be a greater number here, and that is going to be the CO2 that your body produced. So what are the pros and cons of using this indirect calorimetry method? So the main pro is it's accurate for steady state oxidative metabolism, so aerobic metabolism over short periods of time. So unlike doing the direct calorimetry where we needed them in the room for, you know, multiple hours in order to get that heat exchange, here we can hook the machine up, and once they're at a steady state, we can take measurements, you know, breath by breath, and average them for 15 seconds up to about a minute, which is the pretty standard range. And you typically don't want to go less than 15 seconds, but, you know, 15 seconds to a minute averages is going to give you a nice stable value that's going to be pretty accurate. So what are the cons here? It requires some fairly elaborate equipment, some expensive equipment, not as expensive as an entire room constructed for a direct calorimetry, but still expensive. And it does not measure anaerobic energy production. So direct calorimetry can measure heat regardless if it was aerobic or anaerobic energy. This cannot. This can only measure aerobic energy production, but at rest and during submaximal exercise, a large percentage of our exercise energy usage is aerobic, so it's still a pretty good measurement. And it's, you know, as I already mentioned, it's still pretty expensive. These machines cost, you know, $20,000 to $30,000 typically, if not more. So it's a fairly expensive piece of equipment. So if you're looking at information on VO2, and you're going to see terms like VO2 max and VO2 peak, the next video in this series is going to be talking about what is the difference between a VO2 max and a VO2 peak. So I'll put a link in the description below this video for that. I'll also put a link in the description below this video to a series, a playlist that I have doing various fitness calculations. If you look through that playlist, you'll see a lot of calculations talking about VO2 and various things you can do with VO2, including calculating the number of calories the person uses at a certain exercise intensity based on VO2.